with me, if you have it, Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. Of course, y'all know this text very well. It is probably the most powerful and most clear description of spiritual authority right here. Verse 1, now when he concluded all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum, and a certain centurion servant who was dear to him was sick and ready to die. So when he heard about Jesus, he sent elders of the Jews to him, pleading with him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they begged him earnestly. Yeah, but just notice that right there. They begged him earnestly. You think maybe he didn't want to go? It didn't say they just asked him. He said, sure. They begged him, saying the one for whom he should do this was deserving, for he loves our nation and has built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them, and when he was already not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying to him, Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Therefore, I did not even think myself worthy to come to you, but say the word, or you may have it in your Bible, speak the word, or say in a word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man placed under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turned around and said to the crowd that followed him, I say to you, I have not found such great faith. Notice Jesus makes the connection between authority and faith. Just keep that in mind. I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And those who were sent, returning to the house, found the servant well, who had been sick. Hallelujah. This is so exciting. Pray with me. Father, we love you today. Thank you for the word of God. Thank you for the anointing that we felt today, God. Thank you, Lord, that under every circumstance, you're still God. You never change. So, Father, have your way right now. Bless me to preach your word, Lord, in Jesus' name. And bless them to hear the word in the name of Jesus. The Lord bless you. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. The disciples asked Jesus several questions concerning the end of time. One of the things that Jesus says, he said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the Son of Man. And this is where we are right now as a nation and on a global scale. We are living in the days of Noah. One of the things that stands out when you read the Genesis account of Noah, the Bible said, and every man did that which was right in his own eyes, which is called basically the spirit of lawlessness. And that is where we are right now. When you listen to the media, you see the actions of people, things that are taking place. But one man was mentioning a few days ago how crime has just exploded in the city of New York, which when Rudy Giuliani came in there back in the 80s, he cleaned up the corruption. New York was a beautiful place to visit and a very safe place to live. But now crime is on the rise because the spirit of lawlessness is beginning to move in. And it is crucial for you and I to understand where we are. And I've said this before, we can't be like ostriches with our heads stuck in the sand just waiting for the rapture to take place. We have to understand where we are. In the eyes of the globalists, the secularists, and the leftists, good is called evil and evil is called good. This mindset and ideology is being pushed on our children from elementary schools all the way to the White House and beyond. The days of Noah are upon us. If you look at the world today and the condition the world is in, if you see the things that are happening over in Israel, Iran now has announced that they're going to be putting a military presence in the Panama Canal that is on the doorsteps of the United States. We've got China that is building up its nuclear arsenal. We have China that is building up its military. They're stating that sometime this year, China will without a doubt attack Taiwan and try to take over Taiwan. And when that happens, Japan and the United States will be drawn in because we are an ally of Taiwan. I'm telling you, friends, Jesus said that before he come that there would be wars and there would be rumors of wars. We are living in the days of Noah. Amen. And with this ideology, even despite global things what's happening in the world, we are seeing a tremendous attack on Christian values, Christian morals, and Christian authority.
Amen.
And when you look at these people, these elitists and these leftist people, they only play by one set of rules. And that is the rules that they make up.
That's right.
To put a twist on it, we are sheep among wolves. We don't just have wolves among the sheep. We have wolves everywhere. And David said it like this. He said, we are like sheep counted for the slaughter. Not saying that we are destined for destruction. It means that we have to face this threat and deal with the real enemy that is behind it all. And that is our adversary, the devil.
Amen.
This world today would love to convince us that we don't matter. If you look at the attack that is taking place on Christianity, they're trying to make it seem like our voice doesn't matter. And the real threat of it all is when we believe it. See, the Bible says that those who believe in lies are going to be damned. In other words, those who believe in the lie will be destroyed and decimated by it. As a child of God and as a remnant of God's people, we have to understand that there's a lot of things that are being said, but we have to hold fast to the truth. That when people are saying this and people are saying that and this is happening and this is going to happen and that is going to happen, we have to understand if we believe everything the enemy is spewing out of his mouth, then we are going to be destroyed by that lie.
Amen.
The Bible said, as it was in the days of Noah, we know that Noah spent years preaching righteousness to the people who are living in a lawless state. And if we are going to escape being destroyed by deception, we not only need to preach righteousness, we've got to start practicing righteousness. We have got to take a stand for God, hold on to the word of God, and live for him unashamed.
Amen.
For Paul said this, he said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. I'm tired of seeing Christians apologizing for who they are and what the word of God says. We need people that will stand up today and say, I am a Christian. I believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, folks, if you're living by the word of God, there's a promise in that word that says that he will keep us all the way until the end. For the gospel is the truth, and the Bible said the truth will make you free. Hallelujah. It is time to get on the ark, folks. It is time to get on the ark. When Noah had finished building the ark, the Lord said, all right, I want you to get everything ready. I'm telling you, now is the time to get ready. It's not tomorrow. It's not a month from now, a week from now. We got people saying, yeah, but before so-and-so end of the year, I'll start going to church. No, it is time to get your mind made up right now that I'm going to live for God. We got to get in the will of God. We got to stand on God's word, and we've got to keep the faith.
Amen.
I'm telling you something, God is going to get us through this. There is a rescue and there is an escape that is coming that no one or no thing can stop, and it's called the rapture. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, folks, this hope that we have here today, it's not just some old archaic saying that they've been saying for thousands of years, but it is a living hope and it's on the horizon. It's there closer than we've ever been. I'm telling you, folks, it's time to get ready, because God is going to bring his children home. He's going to rescue us from the plans and the wiles of the enemy. Is there anybody in this building excited about that day when the rapture comes? Hallelujah. Like Israel coming out of Egypt, we're coming up and we're coming out. How many knows up is out?
Amen.
Up is out. God is taking us up, and God is taking out of this world, taking us from all the pain and the suffering, just like we sung a minute ago. And you know, the Bible says in the last days they will say, well, where is the promise of his coming? I want to tell you something. You ought to be thankful that you believe what you believe.
Yes. Yes.
And I'll just say this. I'll brag on it. Just let me just brag a second. And you go to church where you go to church. Because if there's one thing I will do for my days on this earth, I will preach the truth to you.
Yes.
I will preach the truth. God is going to take us out of here.
Yes, he is.
But it's not time yet.
That's right.
There's still work to do.
Yes.
And you know, the thing is, God doesn't have us here to be the enemy's punching bag.
No.
We're here to hit back.
Amen.
And we're here to hit back hard.
Yes.
See, Jesus gave us a promise for a problem. He said, in this world, you will have tribulation. He said, that's the problem. He said, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. The Spirit of Christ is the great power of God. And if Jesus Christ lives in you, the Bible said we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Hallelujah. Amen. So you know what you are? You're an overcomer. You're a conqueror.
Amen.
So whether you feel like it or not, you still have to declare Jesus Christ speaks the truth. And he said, if I live in you, then you're more than a conqueror. Then no matter what you feel or anybody else tells you, you're an overcomer.
Amen.
So then Jesus gives us a gift. And he said this, he said, I give you power over all the power of the devil, and nothing shall by any means harm you. He said, there is no plan, there is no plot, there's nothing the enemy can do that can hurt you, because I've given you power over the power of the devil. That power is the Spirit of God. Jesus said, I leave, but I'm sending my Spirit. His power is exercised through authority.
Yes.
So in Luke chapter 9, verse 1, Jesus told his disciples, he said, I give you authority and power over devils and to cure diseases. Yeah. Now notice the key word that he says in this text is, he said, I give.
Yes.
It is a divine transfer to do the work that he did. And let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, he done it.
Yes.
They did it. We are going to do it. We've done it before. We're going to do it again. I'm telling you something. We're not leaving this world as some pitiful, ragged out group of abandoned men and women who are barely suffering and getting by. But we're going to do it doing the works of God, fighting tooth and nail all the way to the very end. Because Jesus said, I gave you the authority to do it. And it's time for somebody to rise up and say, yes, we can do it. And we're going to do it for God. So we have authority. Somebody say authority.
Authority.
Authority begins in the mind. Everything begins in the mind. Everything ends in the mind. You've got to know that as a spirit-filled believer, that you have authority. You've got to know it. Not just something that you read about in the Bible or something you heard somebody preach and you walk away out the door saying, I tell you, I wish I had it. If you are a spirit-filled believer, you have got to understand you have authority.
Amen.
And understanding is powerful. You know we talk about in the Bible about wisdom and understanding? Understanding is powerful because when you understand something, it removes the mystery behind it. If you understand how a machine operates, you can go to that machine and you can operate it. Even though you may have the right to operate it, you got hired to do this job and you can operate that machine. Yet we have hired you to run that machine and you walk up there and you don't understand how it runs, you're not going to run it.
Okay.
Had a man tell me one time, I said, I'm looking for a job. Do you have any experience? I said, no, but if you hire me, I will. He said, So I left. Never got the job. So if we understand we have authority, we have to learn how to walk in it.
Yes.
Now look at what Jesus said, Mark chapter 1. Listen to what they said, verse 22. And they were astonished at his teaching, or at his doctrine, if you read the King James, at his doctrine. For he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. So the first key to walking in spiritual authority is to live the Jesus doctrine. You have to live what he preached. For they were astonished at his doctrine. Because he did not teach like the scribes and the Pharisees. So you got to live the Jesus doctrine, which is what? You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. But what was so exciting about Jesus' doctrine was, It was followed by a demonstration. So the Bible said confirming the word with signs following. So signs gave credibility to the word. And the Bible said that when Jesus gave his disciples the authority to go out and cast out devils and cure diseases, the Bible said, and the Lord was working with them. So his power, his anointing, his authority to cast out devils and heal the sick were working in the disciples and working with the disciples as he sent them out to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Friend, I'm telling you that operation and ministry has never stopped. Jesus Christ is still the same today, yesterday, and forever. He's still working in us, for us, and with us. I'll tell you what, we've got to learn how to face this life with boldness. As long as Jesus Christ is working with us and in us, we will never be beaten. So the second key. Let's go to Mark chapter 1 again, verse 27. Because notice this, verse 22, there were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught those one having authority. And all his scribes, and what's the next thing he does? He casts the devil out of the man. Then they say in verse 27, then they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, what is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority he commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. Now, how many know that loud doesn't mean anointed? Sometimes when you get anointed, you get loud. When you think about Jesus commanding an unclean spirit to go, Brother Mike, you think he just jumped up and hollered and screamed and pouring in and said, get out of here. But you know, when the Bible says that when Jesus dealt with the man in the Gadarenes, the devils asked him, could they leave? And he said, sure. And they left. Why? Because of authority. So the Bible said, with authority, he commands. How many of you have the truth living in you?
Amen.
Yes. How many of you live by the doctrine of Jesus Christ? You believe the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Then when you have the truth in you, you can speak that truth, and truth brings freedom. To those who are bound by demonic spirits, you can speak truth over their life, and the truth will make them free. Jesus was the truth. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And they looked around and said, what kind of doctrine is this? Because when he preaches, there was something about what he said that resonated in their spirit. And there was a man that had an unclean spirit, and Jesus cast the devil out of him. And all he did was command him. Friend, we've got to stop cowering in the corner, and we've got to start commanding these things that the devil's interfering with in your life to straighten up and stop, because you have the authority to do it. So if we have the right doctrine, which is the truth, the gospel, why should we be timid and stay silent? He said, command. You know what Jesus said in Mark 11, verse 23, and I'm just paraphrasing here. He said, if you have faith, here again, I want to bring this connection together of faith and authority. He said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you will speak to that mountain and command that mountain to be cast into the sea. And this is what he said. If you do not doubt in your heart, but believe that what you speak will happen. He said, you will have what you say. Hallelujah. That is authority, church. That is authority. I have seen people stand there and speak to people that were filled with devils, and the devils sit back and laugh at them. Why? Because they did not have the authority that they needed. You not only need power living inside of you, you've got to have faith that when you do it, it is going to happen, because that's what God's word says. That's what the gospel preaches. And I stand on this word and we speak with authority. And we speak the word. So from our text and from Matthew 11, Mark 11, 23, we see that there is a connection between faith and authority. Now let's talk about the centurion's faith. It's funny to me, in the Jews' eyes, he's the wrong person, but he's got the right faith. They're the right people, they got the wrong faith. You ain't got an answer, but why is it that people can come off the street that don't know anything about church and can get healed and delivered? And we got church folks that sit there week after week after week, the same issues and same problems. Where's our faith? And I'll tell you, I'll tell you right up front. I struggle with my faith, just like anybody else. But his faith is an amazing thing. And the centurion had never been in one of Jesus' services. He never, far as I know, heard one teaching, nothing. He had just heard about him from somebody else. And when he's in need, he sends for Jesus. He understood. This is what is amazing about it. He understood Jesus' power and ability and who Jesus was simply because the centurion understood authority. He understood authority. He not only believed that Jesus could do it, he knew he would do it. Or he never would have called him. And his understanding of who Jesus was caused him to be aware of his own unworthiness. He said, listen, he said, somewhere between the time he sent the word and Jesus started coming, he's like, wait a second. I'm not worthy for this man to come under my roof. He said, as a matter of fact, he said, I'm not even worthy. He said, to come to you. Talk about humility. And you know what? Seeing our own unworthiness makes Jesus' willingness all that more wonderful and awesome. When I look at myself and I think, man, I am a mess. I will not say a hot mess because I don't even understand what a hot mess is. Somebody said that day, and I said, what? Don't tell me if you know either. But I look at myself and I think, man, what a crazy whatever, you know, I'll call me this. What an idiot I am sometimes. So the way I act, things I say, and things I do. And yet I look at him and I see how willing he is to do it anyway. I'm like, who am I that a king should bleed and die for? Who am I? He saw his own unworthiness, but yet he saw the willingness, and he never allowed his unworthiness to get in the way of Jesus' willingness. When are we going to let him be who he is? When are we going to let God be God? Hallelujah. I know we're not the most stalwart of people, the most stellar people. There's times we make mistakes. We mess up. We're not on our A game, but I love every time we come in his presence and lift up unworthy hands and we feel him. Hallelujah. And we know he's right there.
Yes.
He said, I'm not worthy. He said, but I tell you, all you got to do is just say in a word, and my servant shall be healed. I'm so glad that his word is equal to his power. That whenever he speaks, he's got the power to back it up.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And because of who he is, all he has to say is, it's done and it is done. Jesus said this, all power in heaven and earth has been given unto me. He has all power and all authority.
Amen.
And the centurion's faith was based upon authority. He saw the authority that Jesus has, and he makes this statement, and he says, for I also, Jesus never says anything to him about, do you know who I am? No. He says, listen, he said, I am a man under authority, but I'm also a man that has people under me. And I say to this one, and he does it. You realize that when that centurion looked at his soldier and said, I want you to go do this right here, he never got sassed back. Nobody talked back to him.
Right.
He did it.
Yeah.
Because that soldier knew not only does he have authority, but there's also bigger people above him. And that's what he said. Listen, he said, not only do I have men underneath me who say what I do, he said, but I answer to somebody else too. He had others above him who were greater than him. You know what the Bible says? Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world.
Yes.
The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, lives inside of you, and there is nobody or no thing greater than him. Yes. He said, just say in a word. If we're going to learn how to walk in spiritual authority, we not only have to have the right doctrine, we not only have to learn how to speak the truth, but we also have to learn to submit to authority.
Yes.
Jesus said this. He said, I submit myself, paraphrasing again, I submit myself to the Father.
Yes.
And because he submitted himself to the Father, he said, all power in heaven and earth has been given unto me. Mm-hmm. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. The centurion looked and said, I realize, he said, where your power comes from. It comes through your submission. He submitted, Jesus Christ submitted to the cross. And he took the very thing that was used to take his life, to defeat death, hell, and the grave. How awesome is that? Yes. He took the devil's own weapon and used it against him. And he won it all.
Yes.
When he said all power, he wasn't talking about just a little bit or just here and there. He was talking all power. And he said, I give you all power over the devil. He's talking about every bit of it. See, there was a moment in history when you and I had dominion. Though it brief, Adam was walking in the garden and had dominion and authority over every beast, every animal. But he relinquished that dominion when he believed the lie of the enemy. But there was one called the second Adam who redeemed it and returned it back to humanity. James chapter 4 verse 7 tells us, submit yourself unto God. Put yourself under God's command. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Hallelujah. Do you realize something, that the devil is not greater than you? He is under you. Come on, I want to say it because there's a lot of Christians who don't know it. That devil is not equal to you. He is not greater than you. He is under you. Hallelujah. And you are under somebody else. Hallelujah. And that person, Jesus Christ, that you're under, gives you power greater than all the power of the devil. Hallelujah. Command the enemy. Don't ask him. Don't plead with him. Command him. We have power to command from God. Power to command devils. Power to cure diseases.
Yes.
Come on. We have got to get back to the basics of the Bible again and start believing and exercising what Jesus Christ said that we have. He said, I give you power to cast out devils and I give you power to cure diseases.
Yes. Yes.
Brother Brandon, you're going to be busy, my friend. You're going to be busy. Hallelujah. Because we're going to lay hands on the sick and we're going to see diseases cured. People are going to walk in this building. You're going to walk in buildings somewhere. You're going to walk in stores and you're going to lay hands on folks and you're going to command that disease to come out of their body, and God's going to heal them and God's going to deliver them because he has given you power to do the works that Jesus Christ did.
Amen.
Psalms chapter 8 verse 6, he said, who is man that thou art mindful of him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, but you have crowned him with glory and honor, and you have put all things under his feet.
Yes.
Luke chapter 10:19, Jesus said, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the devil. Hallelujah. Let me ask you a question. What are you going to do with what Jesus just said? What are you going to do when he said, I give you power to tread and trample? I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to pick up my feet and I'm going to tread on these things that I've been dreading. Hallelujah. I'm going to tread upon these things. Hallelujah. That's been telling me it ain't going to make it. You're not going to get through this. It's not going to get any better. It's never going to change. We have the authority through the power of Jesus Christ. Amen. To put these things under our feet. We have power to put demonic interference. Yes. Under our feet. Yes. Power. I'm going to do what I saw in the vision. Is it okay if I be Pentecost for just a while? Yes. Relationship issues. Some folks can't get along with anybody. Emotional pain. Failure. Hold on. I'm all thumbs. Failure. Sickness. This covers a broad one right here. Beautiful sister, would you like to help me? Heart trouble. You can leave it going. Somebody out there needs this too. Grab some. Financial issues.
Look at the one I just got.
Oh. Anybody ever have that? Depression? Worry? No. Nobody has that. Fear? Keep that one. High blood pressure? Arthritis? I can't stand these people saying, if you don't have it, it's coming for you. Well, you know what? You just keep it.
That's right.
Diabetes? Just because mom and daddy had it and grandpa had it and grandma had it doesn't mean I've got to have it.
That's right.
Amen. Everybody in my family on my mother's side that died of some kind of cancer, but I'm not dying of cancer.
Right.
I was told I have no cancer in my body.
That's right.
Discouragement. Anybody ever have any discouragement? Anybody ever dealt with loneliness? You can be sitting in a room full of people and feel like the loneliest person in the world. Did I write failure? Oh, failure twice. Must be for two people. And these are just a few of the issues. When I was praying, I was standing over here and I seen every one of these things wrote out on the floor. And the Lord said, go walk on them. Everything that you see, and even stuff that's not on this floor, stuff that's in your own life, things you deal with, tormenting your mind, thoughts that you have. And I'm not going to write down. I just chalk it up under demonic influence and demonic interference. Mm-hmm. About your ministry, about your mind, about the blessings that God's promised you, about your family's salvation. Will they ever be saved? Were they ever going to come to church? We get over your job. Mm-hmm. All these things. Where the enemy likes to give his little claws in, the enemy likes to begin to interfere. Jesus said, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions. And over all the power, all the influence, all the interference of the enemy. And in Joshua chapter 1 verse 3, he said, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, he said, that have I given unto you. Yes. How would you like to take authority over some of this stuff you've been dealing with?
Yes, yes.
Come on. I want to read one more thing in Joshua chapter 10. We're going to start reading at verse 24. I remember the story. There were five kings that came up against Israel at one time. And the five kings went and hid in the cave. So it was when they brought out those kings to Joshua. that Joshua called for all the men of Israel and said to the captains of the men of war who went with him, come near, put your feet on the neck of these kings. And they drew near and put their feet on their necks. Then Joshua said to them, do not be afraid, nor be dismayed. Be strong and of good courage, for thus will the Lord do to all your enemies against whom you fight. Hallelujah. You notice before he ever gave them the promise, he said, I want you to come up here and put your feet on the necks of your enemies. I want you to tread upon serpents and scorpions. I want you to exercise your authority and put your foot down over these things that are threatening your family, that are threatening your future, that are threatening your life. And I want you to put and know that your God is going to do this to every one of your enemies. Let's stand together right now. Is there somebody right